Amen. Okay. The one who could just conclude this Mishnah, to the Pasuk. Pasuk Ches, Pasuk 8. The Pasuk of Shema ben Mussar Avicha, that here my children, the Mussar of your father, and the Altito Torah Simecha, and don't leave the discipline of your, the teachings of your mother. So we talked about the concept of Shema ben Mussar Avicha ve'Altito Torah Simecha, why it's the Mussar of your father and why it's the Torah of your mother. We give a few explanations. One is that there's really no difference between them. And the other is that, I mean, it was just really a poetic way of saying it, as if Sadhu Goen holds that way. But the other way that we spent a lot of time on yesterday was that the father and the mother speak, the father and mother speak differently. And it's a reminder that when it comes to the Torah of your father, so that you're naturally going to listen to, but you also have to listen to the Mussar of your father. And when it comes to the Mussar of your mother, that you're naturally going to listen to, but you have to listen to her Torah also. I want to take a little bit of a few different tacks today. But one is also, I'd like to explain why it's Shema to Mussar and Titosh to Torah. Because it could have easily said Shema b'ni Mussar avicha, Shema u'shma Torah simecha, and it could have said Lo titosh Mussar avicha v'al titosh Torah simecha. So there's got to be a reason why Shlomo Melech decided to use two different languages, and we'll see that now. Before we get into that, though, I just want to take a little left turn for a moment. We talked about yesterday, in the beginning, the concept of chinuch, and we talked about the concept of education, that we understood that there were three partners in the creation of a person, and that a Kodesh Baruch Hu puts in certain things, and the father puts in certain things, and the mother puts in certain things, and that it is critical that we have the teachings of our parents, and that we listen to our parents, and that it's talking to a child and telling a child that make sure that you listen to your parents. But in that is also an implicit warning to parents. When it says Shema b'ni Mussar avicha, that's telling dad, you know, you got to be dealing with your kid. You know, how many times has it ever happened that you come to a teacher comes into school, looks at a kid, and after a day or two realizes this kid has never been told no. This kid's never been disciplined. No one's ever said a word to this kid. So it's an implicit instruction to a parent that Shema b'ni Mussar avicha, if the child is obligated to listen to the Mussar of the parent, that means that the parent is obligated to give Mussar. And v'altil titosh Torah simecha, and that you can't forsake the Torah of your mother, that's telling the moms, mom, you got to put something into your kids. And you've got to do it in your own unique kind of way. You do it in your own mom kind of way, but you've got to give them real substantial things also. It can't all just be about fluff and about painting and playing. There's got to be some real instruction on there. And you have the ability to do that. You just have to know that you have the mandate to do that. And this is what has to be done. So I think that the first thing that the pasuk is turning to, if we take it, you know, this sort of a macro view, the melitza view, right? Then we understand that what it's saying to us is that if the child is commanded to listen to Mussar Avicha and to not Titosh Torah Simecha, that means that there has to be some Mussar Avicha going on and there has to be some Torah Simecha going on. I also think that it's important to understand that it is again talking to parents, and it's saying that the way that the Rav Sadhu Goen had said it, that it's really the same thing. There's Mussar Imecha also, and there's Torah Avicha also. The Torah is exclusively talking about the Mussar Avicha, but it's not ignoring the Mussar Imecha. And it's talking about the Torah Simecha, but it's not ignoring the Mussar Avicha. It's saying that the father is stronger in Mussar and the mother is stronger in Torah. But what it's saying to us is that it's not an and or. It's not giving you a choice and saying, okay, Shema b'ni Mussar Avicha, and if you have a chance, then you should also Al Titosh Torah Simecha. or Shema Bni, or Al Titish Torah Semecha, if you have a chance, then Shema Bni Mussar Avicha. It's putting them both in the same pasuk and telling us that they're both equal to each other, in the sense that what it's saying is that mom and dad have an obligation, have two obligations, to be able to be speaking one from a place of Mussar, instruction, discipline, one from a place of Torah, that it's got to be a softer kind of place, but that you need both of them, and they both need to be consistent. This is not in two different psukim. It's in one pasuk, and if it's in one pasuk, it means that they are equal to each other, and that they have to be consistent with each other. The Torah Simecha has to fit with the Mussar Avicha, and they can't be two different things. You know, we have an incredible parsha in the Torah. The parsha in the Torah is called the Ben Sora Mora. We're going to get to it in a few weeks' time. The Ben Sora Mora is the rebellious child. And I'll tell you why it's an incredible parsha in the Torah. The reason that it's such an incredible parsha in the Torah is because we learn all of child rearing from there. Now, what is that section? Small section of the Torah, a couple of verses. It says that if your child is 13 years old and from 13 years old in one day to 13 years old in 3 months, it's got a pretty small window of opportunity here, and that the child doesn't listen to the father and the mother, rebels against the parents. The parents can take the child, bring him to the court, to the Shar Iro, to the gates of the city, which is where the court sits, and they can say, Benenu Zeh, Ben Sorim, or this child is a recalcitrant child. Can't control him, can't do anything with him. He's your problem now. And we give him over to the Bezin. The Bezin takes him, Urgamu, they stone him, and they kill him. Sounds right. Really? That's Jewish education in a Torah nutshell. You're having a problem with a kid, 13 years old, just take him outside and kill him. Like what are you wasting your time for? Just kill him. There's no hope for this kid. Done. 13 years old. Done. Write him off. Not just write him off. Get him out of society. Get him out of the world. He's just a bother. It's just the whole passion is like wild. And I only told you like the what we call the Rashi Prakim, like just the very beginning of it. But it's a wild passion. It's a wild thing. To say. So we understand, first of all, that it never happened, it never will happen, it never can happen. The Talmud tells us that the requirements have to be that you have to have a mother and a father that have the same voice. So in other words, when dad says, oh, go outside, and mom says, go outside, that's it, you're done. It's not a Ben Sora Mora, because it's speaking of two different voices. That's what Talmud says, they have to speak of the same voice. Talmud says they have to be the same size. Thomas says they have to look alike. Now, that happens to couples, you know, if they've been married for a long time. I understand, but this is talking about when you're having young kids. What is that? Why is the Talmud interpreting the Torah that way, that you have to have all the same, that you know, the same voice, the same size? The Torah is telling us an incredible message. When mom says one thing and dad says another thing, it doesn't make a difference how mom says it, how dad says it. But if the message that they're giving their child is a different message, then that is not a called Ben Sora Mora. When the child's value system is being presented in one way from the mother and one way from the father, and then the child rebels against that, don't you dare call that child a rebellious child. That's not the child's problem. That's the parent's problem. That's because that child has been hearing dual messages. He's hearing life in stereo, and he's got two different things coming in each one of those speakers. What do you expect from him? That's called a natural, normal, regular, screwed up child. And that, you know, describes like 99% of all children. We got stuff we got to deal with. And, you know, hopefully by the time we become parents ourselves, we've worked out some of that stuff. And then we're always getting double messages. You know, very often parents, they try very hard, but they don't always give the perfect message together. So the Torah tells us that's not called a Ben Sora Mora. Now, that doesn't mean that you're okay. You still have to work on that. You have to work on sounding the same and talking the same and looking the same. In other words, the world's got to look the same to the child, whether it's coming from the mom or coming from the dad. And that the message has to be the same, whether it's coming from the mom or coming from the dad. And that's something that we constantly have to work at. That we're giving the same message. Our value system is, well, and it's not just our value system, but it's what comes out of us, what exudes from us, that a child will look at it and say, oh, that's the values of my parents, that's going to be consistent from the mother and the father. When you have that, and then you have a rebellious child, then you have a problem child. That's a rebellious child. And a rebellious child, there's no fixing a rebellious child. That is better to get him now before, again, this never happens, but conceptually, it's better to take him out of the picture now because he's not going to amount, not going to amount to anything. Because a rebellious person, a person who has in their depths rebelliousness, unless you fix that rebelliousness, which you have a small window of opportunity to do, so then that child's going to be a problem all of his life. He's going to get a job. He's going to have a problem with his boss. He's going to get married. He's going to have a problem with his wife. He's going to have kids. He's going to have a problem with his kids. He's going to have problems with brother-in-laws. He's going to have problems with aunts and uncles. This kid is going to be a person that has problems with everybody. We've seen them. We know they exist. Because they're oppositional. That's what the Torah is telling us. The oppositional, those that have, you know, they even have a name for it, a disorder for it, shkayach, just put that to the side. But let's talk about regular kids and regular parenting. Regular kids and regular parenting, the biggest challenge is that mother and father have to sound the same. And the thing that the Torah is telling us, Shema b'ni Mussar avicha v'yaltitash Torah simecha, you're going to get Mussar from the dad, you're going to get Torah from the mom, but they're complementary to each other. And as long as they're complementary to each other, so then you're going to be able to raise an okay child. And every once in a while we slip up, but we can fix those things. But when the father speaking one way in one pasuk and the mother speaking another way in another pasuk, when they're in two different worlds, then that's when the real problems begin. And I think that is also an underlying, like the melitza that we spoke about, that's like another underlying message here in the structure of this pasuk. Now I'll tell you something I think that we have to be very cognizant of. There is a very specific reason why the Torah says, Shema b'ni, Mussar avicha, v'al titash Torah simecha. The Mussar that's being described here in the Pasuk, that's being alluded to in the Pasuk, is instruction that sometimes comes with a certain harshness. You know, a father sees in their child, in their son, that they're not taking to davening. Now, to punish the kid that he has to daven or he has to sit in shul is never going to work. You're going to yield nothing out of it. As a matter of fact, you'll send the child go in the opposite direction. But nevertheless, there are certain parameters and expectations that you have to set for a child, especially if it's a child that's in essence a good kid, really wants to grow, but he's a kid. So sometimes you have to set boundaries and then operate within those boundaries. I expect you to be in shul from X until Y. And when you're in shul, I expect that you're not talking and I expect that you're davening. Now, to sit on top of them and to watch them every second, and when they lift their eyes from the sitter, you whack them in the head, that's not going to work. But to give those parameters, that's an important thing, that a child has to be told no, that a child has to be told, these are the parameters you're going to operate in. This is the world you're going to operate in. And that's critical. I found it in school as a teacher. I found that when the students had an expectation, they understood what you expected of them. So then it was much easier for them to operate with inside that. Now they would do their own shtick. You know, it doesn't mean that they never got in any trouble, but that they knew what was expected of them. And most of the time they would rise to the occasion. I remember that we had in our school, we had mesibas. We had these parties for Hanukkah and Purim and whatever. And in the beginning they were disastrous because we had never told the kids what we expected of them. They had never seen a mesiba. They had never seen this before. We had grown up with them. We had seen them in high school. We had seen them in yeshiva. We had seen them. This was part of our lives. It was a Hanukkah mesiba where we sat around with the Rebbe and we sang and we ate and we rejoiced. It was pashatas. But these kids were coming from a different place. They had no idea. So the Rebbe and we're talking. So we said, why don't we just tell them what we expect of them? We expect that when we come in, this is what's going to happen. We're going to sit down. We'll eat a little bit. Then one of the rabbis is going to start singing. We sing along with him. And then one of them is going to talk. And we stay inside when you talk. And the mesiba, the next mesiba, the Hanukkah mesiba, was beautiful. It didn't mean that there wasn't a kid that didn't walk out. It didn't mean that there wasn't a kid or two that wasn't there or was, you know, distracted. No question about it. But that the general populace understood this is what we have to operate in. We weren't punishing anybody. That wasn't our style. We weren't punishing anybody. We weren't going to do anything punitive to anyone, but we just laid out the parameters. For a kid that can't operate inside parameters, that's Mussar. That's like smacking them with a 1x2. That's hard and it's harsh. To say, I expect this of you, I expect that you sit inside, the minute you say, I expect you to sit inside, you are pretty much guaranteed that that child now has a challenge to have to be able to sit inside. This is something I'll talk about at other times, but there's an amazing understanding from the Navi, from the Torah, that when you tell somebody to go right, so there's a mechanism inside of them that naturally wants to go left. That's the reason why HaKadosh Baruch Hu told us on certain things that we would never touch, he made them into mitzvahs. Right? We're told that if you don't eat blood, it's a mitzvah not to eat blood, right? It's a prohibition, not allowed to eat blood. But who's going to eat blood? I mean, no one's going to, I've said this before, right? No one's going to drink no one's going to walk in for a blood cocktail in a bar, right? No one's going to be drinking blood. So why does the Torah have to make a mitzvah for it? So I went a different tack the last time we spoke about it, but because once the Torah tells me don't do it, I can now get reward for it because now I have a challenge inside not to do it. All of a sudden now it's an opportunity. It's an option. It's an option. Maybe that's like I want to drink blood because you told me I can't. Now you can't say this consciously. You don't really recognize this consciously, but there's something going on inside of a person when they're told to do something. So then they have a natural. Now for some people it's very small and you can get over it very, very quickly. And you don't even recognize that you're going through it. But for others, it's a huge challenge. Mussar that we're talking about here is the challenge to a person, but the challenge is coming not from, you're a bad boy. The challenge is coming from, this is what I expect of you. And once you have that expectation, now you're in a difficult place. And sometimes it's harder to hear the harsher words of the father. When the father sets the, sit up straight, say thank you to your mother, right? When the father has to discipline that child, he has to be tough with the child, then on many children, that's now a challenge. And therefore, the Navi says, Shlomo Melech, the Chacham Mikol Adam says, Shema Bini Musavicha. You have to hear the message. Get over the fact that it's harsh. Get over the fact that it's challenging you and hear what your dad is asking of you. What your dad is asking of you is to be a mensch. What he is asking you is to be a human being. You know, a lot of times we deflect instruction from other people with the following words. I didn't mind what they said, but I did not like the way they said it, which really translates into, you can't tell me anything. Because if you understood the message, you would be able to look at it and say, you didn't say it great, but it doesn't matter. I hear the words. I hear what you're saying to me. And I remember once, I think I mentioned this once, but I remember that they put out once pamphlets in the shul. There was a big campaign not talking in shuls. Our shul happened to be a very quiet shul. I was once away for Shabbos, and there was a visiting rabbi from Los Angeles, and he was there. He started off his speech by saying, this is an unbelievable thing. He says, I've never seen this before in my entire life. He says, besides the fact that the shul is quiet, the rabbi is not even here, and the shul is still quiet? That's unbelievable. Right, so we, Baruch Hashem, we didn't have a very talky shul. But there was a chevret that sat in the back. I know you're surprised, right? But there was a chevret that sat in the back of the shul. That's why backs of the shuls were made, right? So really the smartest kind of shul you could build is build a shul and around. Build a shul around with one row all the way around. It's like, do it 5 miles. It doesn't make a difference. But one row all the way around so there's no back of the shul. If there's no back of the shul, then it's not going to, you know, the riffraff is not going to collect there, right? Like the bottom of a sieve. So the guys back in the shul, and they couldn't keep quiet. And nobody could say anything to them. The most religious guys went over to them. The most popular guys went over to them. Like, nobody could get these guys to be quiet. So one guy found these pamphlets that were giving out. One day, maybe I'll even show you these pamphlets. It was every negative thing that was said in Chazal, anywhere, in any book ever in the past, you know, 1,000 years about talking in shul, of how your tongue is going to fall out, your eyes are going to fall off, you know, your kids are going to die, God forbid, things are going to happen to your children, and you're going to lose your ilam habit. Like every negative thing that it could say possibly about talking in shul, it printed on this thing with the quote, the book, the number, and they put it out on the seats of the shul. So for the guys that don't talk, they're saying, wow, you know, I'm safe. The guys that talk came out, every one of them looked at this, and I saw them sitting in the back. This now, all we did was we fueled them for more talking because they were sitting there and they were ripping apart. You know, these guys were what we call lamdanim. You know, these were, you know, knowledgeable guys. We're looking at them going, yeah, and you could see them the whole dominating. They were cocking. They were like cooking over this thing. They were insulted. They were. You want to tell me to stop speaking in shul? Then tell me nicely to stop speaking in shul. But don't do it this way. Shkayach, buddy. Hate to break the news to you. For the past 5 years, people have been telling you to stop talking in shul. So, you know, the nice is gone. But if you don't want to hear and you want to be insulted, you'll be insulted when somebody tries to push you. So then your last resort is to hide behind the way you said it to me. It's got nothing to do with the way you said it to me. I'm not hearing the message, because if I heard the message, I would say, thank you very much. One guy who happens to be a pretty nasty person happened to have come over to me afterwards and said, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Now, it didn't stop him from talking in shul, but he got it. He mamish got the point. And he came over and he said, thank you. That's the way, that's what Shlomo HaMelech is instructing us. Shema b'ni l'musar v'icha. Listen to the Musa. Don't get lost in the medium. Don't get lost in the outer trappings. Don't get lost in the shtick. Shema b'ni. Listen beyond the words and understand the message you're being told. The message you're being told is be a mensch. And then we turn to the child and we say, and al titaish teres nechel. Because mom, with the softness, with a smile, with rachmanis, she's able to get these messages into her children. It's easy to hear mom's message. It's much easier to hear a message of you're the greatest. You know, mom looks at the child and says, no, Tatala, it's okay. You know, nobody can tell you that you're a bad boy. You're so wonderful, right? Mommy looks at you and says, no, Tatala, don't lift the package. If it's too heavy for you, don't wait. Your father will take care of it. Don't worry. You don't have to lift the package. Right? The mother has a rahmanis on the child. To hear mom's message is very easy. Mom's message touches the soul. You know, the Gemara says that if you need to remove a parent from the house, which is the parent that should be removed? It doesn't say it quite this way. I'm putting it in these terms. But the Talmud is telling us that the mother is more important in the house than the father. Because what a mother can give a child, a father can't give a child. Sometimes that comes through when a mother is nursing a child. Other times it comes through as a mother is raising a child. But that the confidence, the self-esteem, the love, all of that, that's something, and it doesn't mean that a father does the opposite, ruins it, but it's not his kayach. It's a mother's kayach. Father can learn how to do it, but a mother, it's her natural kayach to be able to do it. To hear the mother's message is much easier to hear those messages. Problem holding on to them. Problem is because they came so softly and they came so purely that to hang on to them, to staple them inside, that's sometimes more difficult. When it comes with a little bit of harshness, the advantage of that is that sometimes you only hear that way, and sometimes it lands because of that. Sometimes when it comes too softly, you don't hear it, and you don't even recognize that the message was there. And that's why Shlomo Melech turns to us and says, "V'al titaish teresimecho." That softer message, that direction of your mother, so make sure al titosh, don't leave it, don't deviate from it. Don't forsake the teachings of your mother. Shema, get it through your head. And if you mistake, hold on to it. Don't, because even though it's not, you know, you can talk to your children from today till tomorrow about X. I'm not going to name X. Talk to them about X, which is very important to you. And you tell them that, you know, this is something like a do or die, make or break in your relationship. This is it, X. And the truth is, you can say it in a way that you can let your child know that they could lose their lives, meaning they lose their relationship, lose everything, if X is not fulfilled. Or you can present it in a way that, you know, it's a beautiful thing, it's important to us, that we live our life by, but you don't necessarily set down any kind of parameters. So to hold on to that message is much more difficult because it doesn't land inside in the same kind of way. That's why he changed those words from when he talks about the Mussar Avicha and the Torah Simecha. The quality you need to make that message endure is different for the Mussar Avicha than it is for the Torah Simecha. It's Shema. You need to listen, to really in the depths, understand what they're saying. And in the Torah Simecha, you understand what they're saying, but I'll teach you. You have to hold on to it and staple it inside. Make it part of your very existence and your basic structure of your value system, and then you can ensure that it's not going to go away. Okay, that's what I saw in this pasuk. I think that the lessons there's a Rabag, there are other commentaries that that go into other things, but there's this. I think that this is the essence of the pasuk. Okay, everybody should have a wonderful, beautiful, amazing, awesome day. Any comments?
Just so much. One little sentence.
But that's what you'll see in the book of Mishlei. Sometimes we won't even be able to get through a whole sentence. Sometimes we'll get stuck on the first half or the second half, because remember, this was written by the deepest of the deep, by a person. This is written by Shlomo Melech, whose perceptions were so incredibly deep that when he said the tip of the iceberg, you know, sometimes when you start to dig in that iceberg, you find just incredible, incredible things. It's not much different than the Torah in that sense. And that's why, remember, the Vilna Gaon described it as Zafokba, Vafokba, the Kulaba, turn it over again, because everything is in it. But you just see that sometimes in the most magnificent way when you try to start to scrape into it a little. Okay, thank you very much, everyone. Have a beautiful, wonderful, amazing day. And we'll
thank
see you tomorrow.
So much.
Wow.
Thank you, Rabbi. Have a good day, everyone.
Good day, guys.
Have a good day.